Welcome back, and in this lesson I want to cover the architecture of public AWS services and private AWS services. Now this is something that I cover in all of my courses. It's pretty foundational to how AWS works from a networking and security perspective. The differences I talk about in this lesson might seem tiny, but I promise that taking the time to understand them fully will really help you to grasp some of the more complex network and security products or architectures throughout your studies. AWS services can be categorized into two main types: public services and private services. Now, if you don't have much in the way of AWS experience, then you might immediately assume that a public service is accessible to everyone and a private service isn't. Right at the offset, I want to reset any assumptions that you might have. When you hear the term AWS private service and AWS public service, it's referring to networking only. A public service is something which is accessed using public endpoints, such as the simple storage service known as S3. S3 can be accessed from anywhere which has an internet connection. A private AWS service is something which runs within a VPC, so only things within that VPC or what is connected to that VPC can access the service. For both of these, there are permissions as well as networking. So even though S3 is a public service, by default, an identity other than the account root user has no authorization to access that resource. So permissions and networking are two different considerations when talking about access to a service. When reviewing public versus private services, at least as far as this lesson is concerned, it's the networking which matters. When thinking about any sort of public cloud environment, most people instinctively think of two parts, two types of the network, two zones. First is the internet. This is the zone where internet-based services operate from, things like online stores, Gmail, and various online games. So if you're sat at home playing an online game or watching training videos, chances are you're connecting to the internet via an internet service provider. So this is the internet zone. Then we have private networks. So if you're watching this video from home, then your home network is an example of a private network. Only things which are directly connected to a network port within your house or people who have your Wi-Fi password can operate in your personal private zone network. Now, AWS also have private zones, and these are called virtual private clouds or VPCs. These are isolated, so VPCs can't communicate with each other unless you allow it, and nothing from the internet can reach these private networks unless you configure it. Services can be placed into these private zones, such as EC2 instances, and just like with your home network, it can only access the internet, and the internet can only access it if you allow it and you configure it. Many people think this is how AWS is architected, that there are two network zones, the internet and private zones, but there's actually a third zone, the AWS public zone, and this runs between the public internet and the AWS private zone networks. So this is not on the public internet and it's not part of the public internet, it's a network which is connected to the public internet. Now this distinction might seem irrelevant, but as you learn more about advanced AWS networking, the distinction really matters. This AWS public zone is the network zone where AWS public services operate from, services with public endpoints such as S3. So just to summarize, try and really understand this fundamental concept. We've got three different network zones: the public internet, the AWS private zone, which is where VPCs run from, and the AWS public zone, which sits in the middle, and this is where AWS public services operate from. Now, if you access AWS public services from anywhere with a public internet connection, your communication uses the public internet for transit to and from this AWS public zone. This is why you can access AWS public services from anywhere with an internet connection, because the internet is used to carry packets from you to the AWS public zone and back again for the return journey. Now, I'm going to be covering this in depth later in the course, but you can also configure virtual or physical connections between on-premises networks and AWS VPCs. So private networks can be connected together, but again, only if you decide to allow it. You can also create and attach an internet gateway to a VPC, which I'll be covering in depth later in the course. This provides a few additional pieces of functionality. First, it allows private zone resources to access the public internet as long as EC2, in this example, has an allocated public IP address. It also allows access to public AWS services such as S3, but crucially, and this is important, this data doesn't touch the public internet at any point. It communicates with the public service using the AWS public zone. Now, I mentioned this moments ago, but it's possible to give private resources such as EC2 instances a public IP address, and this allows the resource to be accessed from the public internet. Architecturally, what this is doing is projecting the EC2 instance into the public zone so that all of that instance or part of it can be communicated with from the public internet. So this is the architecture, the three different network zones which you need to be aware of to do well in the real world and this specific exam. So we've got the public internet, the AWS public zone, and the AWS private zone. And as I mentioned at the start of this lesson, as you learn ever more advanced networking features of AWS, these three network zones become really critical to understand. Now at this point, that's everything I wanted to cover in this lesson. So go ahead, complete the video, and when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next lesson.